Is it possible to squeeze all the glue out of a joint? Can regular wood glue be used as a gap filler? Does surface treatment make much of a difference in terms of how strong a joint is? Those are all questions I was curious about, so I made a whole lot of test pieces and I glued them together all with regular carpenter's glue, because that's the glue I use all the time. And I've got my apparatus here and I'm going to break some of these things and measure how much force it takes with the scale here and record it at the same time, and we'll see which joints do best. So I got my bathroom scale here and I've got a pivoting thing for the jack and put that on here. And the jack weighs a few pounds, so I'm just going to adjust to zero to compensate for the jack. So when there's zero, there's no force. And here's a joint, the first one I'm going to break. And this one is just sanded with 10-pound clamping force. And I'm extending that a little bit here to apply the force here, because looking at some of my old tests, if I tried to apply the force here, that would exceed the 300 pounds that my scale can do. Record. And this is sample number one, sanded with a 10-pound clamping force. And here we go. 20, 140, 150, 160. Whoa! Well, I'll have to review the video for how much force that actually was. That's why I have a camera on the scale. All right, sample number two, 20, go. So that one only got it to about 110 pounds. So this is sample number three. This is the first one where I actually tried to squeeze all the glue out of it, and I also scraped the surface, which could potentially make the glue not stick as well. So let's see how that one does. 30, 40, 50, 110. Oh, it's done. Let's call that 110. Sample number four. This one is where I tried the gap filling properties. So I sanded the surface and I put about half to a third of a millimeter of gap in there and lots of glue to see how well the glue would fill the gaps. So let's give that one a try. 150, 155, better hold this when it goes. 155, 160, 165, 170, ooh. 175, there we go. Let's call that 170. All right, this sample is one where I was experimenting with the idea of a dry tenon. What a lot of furniture makers will do is they will put glue only in the mortise and none in the tenon, so that when you squeeze the tenon into the hole, you don't get any squeeze out. I'm skeptical as to whether that makes for a good joint. So in this one, I put only glue on this part and then I slid the other part on top like that to simulate like sliding a dry tenon into a hole with glue in it. So let's see how that one will do. 10, 20, 30, 35, 40. Oh, went already. Yeah, that felt pretty good. So dry tenons, not a good idea. Okay, this is another regular, just sand it with a 10-pound weight on it when I clamped it, just as a reference again. So let's see how that one does. 160. 160.
95, 100, 100 pounds only.
75, well, it's the best of those so far. 135.
So here's my results, and here's the numbers, which I then worked out by category, and I punched these all into a spreadsheet. So here's my raw readings, and then by category. So not unexpected, the tenon with no glue on it was much weaker than the other joints. Sanded or scraped didn't make a huge difference. Surprisingly, the scraped ones were slightly stronger than the sanded ones, at least for the lightly clamped ones. When I clamped them really hard, basically trying to squeeze all the glue out of the joint, the scraped and clamped hard joints were particularly weak. So when clamping really hard, Sanding was a bit better than scraping. And what's really interesting is the joints where I left a gap of 0.3 millimeters were actually the strongest.
So that the gap joints were the strongest actually really surprised me. And if you combine that with the fact that the dry tenon experiments were the weakest, if you now just make a mortise that's really, really loose and just literally fill that with glue and squeeze the tenon into it, that may still be a strong joint, although it'll still be messy.